إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة في البدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى أيضا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن اهتدى بإحسان إلى يوم الدين فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله صدق الله العظيم My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, It is indeed a great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to be gathered here for Salatul Jumu'ah. For it is indeed a great ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are given the health and the strength, the time off from our jobs, from our schools. And He has given us the ability and the willingness and the desire to make the effort to be here. So we begin by sending all praise and thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His bounties upon us, that which we know and that which we are not aware of. We send our salam and our salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and upon his companions, upon his household, and upon all those who follow him in righteousness until the end of time. My dear brothers and sisters, my khutbah this afternoon is a very simple topic, and it is based on a word that is found in the ayah that I recited in the last part of the initial part of the khutbah. And this word is hub, love. As we are living in a Western society, we know that these days are coming up to a day in which many people will be celebrating the emotion of love. So I think it is only prudent that we remind ourselves of love and its place in Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith it is narrated that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked him about the hereafter. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "What have you prepared for that time?" The man replied, "Nothing except that I love Allah and I love you." And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered him, "You are with the ones that you love." In another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "A person will not taste the sweetness of Iman until three things. A person will not taste the sweetness of Iman until three things. The first of which is that Allah and His Rasul become more beloved to him than anything else in the entire world. That Allah and His Rasul becomes more beloved to him. Again, we see the word love than anything else in the entire world. Secondly, that a person loves someone only for the sake of Allah. Only for the sake of Allah. Truly love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, the word love. And then we have the opposite of the word love. And the third part is that he will hate re-entering into kufr as much as he would hate entering into the fire of Jahannam. أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. My dear brothers and sisters, love is indeed a central part of Islam. As a matter of fact, if we were to truly examine Islam in a very deep way, we will see that we will not actually be Muslims. We cannot be Muslim without the element of love in our heart. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he embodied this in his life and in his words, and it is narrated in a speech that he gave to the Sahaba when they migrated to Medina. In the first speech, he said to his companions, he said, "Verily, the best discourse is the book of Allah. One is truly successful whose heart Allah has adorned with the love of his book, and whom after living in denial, Allah has caused to enter into submission to him, and cause him to prefer his book above any human discourse. The book of Allah is the most beautiful and eloquent of discourses. Love that which Allah loves. Love Allah with all your heart. Grow not weary of hearing the word of Allah, and do not stop remembering him. Do not let your hearts grow hard towards him. For verily Allah has preferred his book above all of creation. Indeed, Allah has endowed it with guidance for the best of deeds, and made it an example for the elect of his servant, and filled it with righteous discourse, and has made clear in it what is lawful and what is unlawful. So serve Allah alone and associate no partner with him. Be ever conscious of him. Be truthful to Allah in what you utter from your mouth. Let the spirit of Allah be the source of love between you." And this is a translation. In this short discourse, we can see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam establishing the element of love. And we are speaking here about a different kind of love that most of us would experience in our life. And why am I speaking about this? I'm speaking about the love of Allah. Because there are different types of love. And as believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are also different levels of our love. The first of which, the highest of which, and the best of which should be given for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart of the believer should become the most beloved thing. Because let us be honest, when you really love something is when you will make the most effort for it, isn't that so? When you truly love someone is when you will make all effort to make sure that they are pleased with you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his infinite mercy and wisdom, he guided us to this fact. He guided us to the point of loving him and show us this path of being obedient to him. And thereafter comes the love of the Rasul. And this is based on the ayah that I mentioned earlier. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's saying, "Say, O Muhammad, say to the people, say that if you say you love Allah, if you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, follow me, follow the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to love you." Many people today, when it comes to the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everyone likes to say, "I love Rasulullah. I love Rasulullah." But in the words of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anh, he said, "We do not know that which is in the hearts of people, but we could judge people based on the actions that they do." Professing the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't necessarily mean that you truly love Rasulullah. For the best way of showing the love of Rasulullah, of exemplifying the love of Rasulullah, is by following the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in every possible way that we can. And this is not an option for us as believers. This is a commandment. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentioned in the Quran, He called Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam by a specific term, a title, Uswatun Hasana. The best of example. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam as a final mercy to mankind, as a mercy to all of mankind, the Khatamun Nabiyyin, the seal of our prophets, and the sacrifices that he has made to bring us this deen. And he lived his life in an exemplary manner. And in his life, in this exemplary manner of him living his life, we will see the element of love. We will see love in the way that he deals with others. Many people that became attracted to Islam, not only so much through the words of Rasulullah, but in his dealings with them. We see the same for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And we see the same for all of the Sahabas radiallahu alayhi. It was said that when they came to battle, they were like warriors, they were like tigers, like animals. They were very, very fierce in battle. However, out of that, they were the most gentle of people. They were very gentle people. We see the exemplary character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when they conquered reconquered Mecca, the Fath al-Mecca, and in Mecca they found the people who orchestrated the murder of their families and their friends and stole their wealth and everything and even chased them out of their home. He was a conquering army. Easily he could have said, kill these people. But what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam opened his arms and welcomed them into Islam. And we see even to the son of Abu Sufyan, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he became one of the khilafah of Islam. And his mother orchestrated the murder of Hamza radiallahu anhu, and she became a sahabiya of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, love is not divided in Islam. But sometimes, as Muslims, all that we're hearing about Islam, especially sometimes we might listen to people who don't really understand Islam, and they practice this religion based on hearsay and based on traditions rather than truly understanding this religion. We find children will complain about fathers being brutal and not showing love to them. Wives complaining of husbands, husbands complaining of wives. Or we might tend to forget that Islam is rooted around love. Our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is rooted around that. And that is why, after Allah and His Rasul, the next person we should show all love and devotion to is our mother. As we know the famous hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the man three times, your mother, your mother, your mother. And this is where love for our parents is the third most important love that we must have in our heart. Loving our mother above every other human being in the world, even more than our wives, more than our children, more than our fathers, more than everybody. We must love our mother. Because we can never repay her. Never. After which is our father. But the beauty is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a narration, it is mentioned that a person can only repay their father if they find him as a slave and they bought him and set him free. In today's world, can we ever repay our father? But our mother, no matter what we do, even if we were to carry her on our back for 9 months, like she carried her in her womb, we still will not be able to repay her. Do we show love and respect and honor and dignity to our mothers? How often today we want to go by, you know, it's Valentine's Day, you like a girl, right? And your mother is like, you know, I don't like her, maybe for good reasons, but you are so disobedient to your mother. You're going to disregard everything that she would have done for you to bring you up and nourish you and help you for some other person. Who is not even related to you? Who tomorrow can find somebody else and just leave you aside? It's a reality of the world that we are living in. And this brings me to the point of love between a man and a woman. Because this is a very, very hot topic today. Each and every one of us, we will admit that in order for us to be happy, we need to have love, right? We need to have love. And there's absolutely nothing wrong to love a person in a marriage. You're married to them, you have to love them. Show that love. Make them feel that love. All right? And love, as long as it is done in a haram manner, it is astaghfirullah. As long as it is done in a halal manner, it is absolutely halal. However, in our livelihood, in our daily lives, we tend to transgress the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We tend to transgress the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, if a boy sees a girl and he fancies her, a girl sees a boy, and they want to be with each other, instead of doing that which is halal, what they do? WhatsApp, Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook, all of that. Alright, and this is the mentality that our young people have today. That this will open the door of love and happiness for them. But let us look at the statistics of today. You like statistics, right? Our young people. Statistically, we have more broken homes today than any other time in the history of mankind. And as a result, we have children who are suffering because of those broken homes. And then we will sit and we will criticize the traditions of our foreparents. Rather than taking the good from it, rather than understanding the fabric of marriage and the importance of it in a society, and starting it off in the right foot, no, we start it off in haram. How do we expect the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be there? How? Today, in these days, you will see our Muslim brothers and sisters, young, single Muslim brothers and sisters involved in the same filth and misguided actions as the kuffar. There will be no difference between them and a kafir. They will get drunk, they will smoke, they will get high, they're going to fornicate and adulterate and go to the bars and involve in everything. All in the name of love for your friends or some other person. Subhanallah, love has even become perverted today. That it is no longer just the fitna of a man and a woman. But the fitna of homosexuality has permeated into our society. That even Muslims today want to express that as that is part of Islam. That kind of love, that is haram. But love is beautiful when it is done right. As in the words of Shaykh Uthaymeen rahimahullah alayh, he said, a person may hear that a woman is of good character and virtuous and knowledgeable, so he may want to marry her. Or a woman may hear that a man is of good character, virtuous and knowledgeable, and religiously committed, so she may want to marry him. But contact between the two who admire one another in ways that are not Islamically acceptable is the problem. Many people you're going to hear, but brother, you know, she calls me and wakes me up for Fajr in the morning. Right? Or she likes when I read Quran to her, like if that's an excuse to involve in that kind of conversation. No, it is haram. Alright? And the worst thing than committing a sin is fooling ourselves to things that we are not committing a sin. And inshallah, if you were to listen to the presentation this evening by Sheikh Nazim Habibullah, you will hear the concept of the best of sinners are those who make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But a person can only turn back in repentance to Allah when they acknowledge that sin, and that is a major problem today. We involve in it, but we don't want to accept that it's a sin. It's haram. We are doing something that which is haram. And why it is haram? Because it opens the door of fitna. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, do not come near to zina. Don't come near to it. Don't approach it. How do we approach it? They say that the eyes are what? The windows to the soul, to the heart. You look at something, you want it. It's natural. You see a Lamborghini on the road, many of the young men are like, hey, nice car, you know, you want something like that. You see a beautiful woman or a handsome young man, the girls or the boys, you know, they appreciate it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he showed us that this is natural. When he saw the young man looking at the girl, what did he do? He turned his head away and reminded him, the first glance is for you, but the rest is sin. There's nothing wrong when we look at something, we might become attracted to it, but sometimes we don't want it. Sometimes you don't want that attraction. Every single man that is sitting here will tell you, they will walk on the road and they can see a woman and they might be attracted to her, but a person who is truly conscious in Allah and truly faithful to their marriage, they're going to eradicate that attraction immediately. They're not going to allow it to fester into their heart. But those people whose heart has become darkened and forget that their first love is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're going to allow this evil type of love to fester. And what will be the outcome? Nothing but haram. Nothing but haram. So in this time of love, in this time of demonstration of love, let us remember, for every single emotion that we might have, there can be a halal tariqa, a halal way towards it. Let us choose the halal way. Let us choose that. Let us help to eradicate some of the sicknesses in our society. As Muslims, let us eradicate it from ourselves first. Let us eradicate it. Right? It is once said that if you want to destroy a nation without wars or violence, then let immorality run rampant among its people. And let us look at today. Let us look at today. My young brothers and sisters today, subhanAllah, even from my generation, I'm not that older than some of you here. Alhamdulillah. The fitna has risen so much, much less the past generation. It is so hard. As soon as you open your phone, it is there. And there on whatever haram that you're seeing, it's molding your heart as to what your as to what your idea of what love should be, of what your idea of beauty should be. And you're not realizing how this is destroying the purity within you. That is why many brothers today, they get married and they no longer find their wives attractive. Their wives attractive. Why? Because of incessant pornography. These are things that hamper that which is halal. We have our sisters today, their idea of what a man should be is fueled or is formed by people who are not Muslims, or even people who are Muslims, but they're the people upon this path of sin. But those are the people that we allow into our eyes, into our minds, into our hearts, to corrupt the purity of love in our hearts as to what we love and how we love. So much so that if you don't give a girl a certain size of diamond, she will think you don't love her. If a girl doesn't do a certain thing, you know, be with her husband a certain way, he will think she doesn't love him. Oh, why? Why is it that our mind and this pure thing of love that's supposed to bring people together, we allow it to become corrupted? Why, my dear brothers and sisters? It stems back to one thing, that our first step into it, in order to fulfill and be happy, as I mentioned, we are all happy when we're in love. We take that step and start walking that path in haram. So in these days, my dear brothers, for those of you who are married, every day show love to your wife. You don't have to wait on Valentine's Day to go buy her a flower, or buy her some chocolates, or buy her some gift. Wake up in the morning and make her some breakfast. You know, she has a neck ache, go and rub her neck. Be a husband, be her best friend. Be that person that she can fall in love every day with. And similarly for the sisters, go and let your husband be your lover. You're married, it's halal. And indulge in it, and that is good. It will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for my unmarried brothers and sisters, yes, it is natural for you to see someone that you love and you appreciate. And if you've already taken that step in a haram way, it is never too late to pull back. You like a girl, go and talk to her father. Show the man some respect, because when you get a daughter, you won't want some guy to be fooling around with her without your knowledge. No. Why are you doing that to someone else? Or you won't want that for your sister? No. You want to marry her, you really respect her, you really love her, then go and speak to her father. Man up. That is the Islamic way. My dear sisters, you like a brother, you're interested in him, you want to marry him, you want to make it halal, you want to make it blessed, then speak to your father. Speak to your wali. I'm interested in this guy. Don't go sneaking around. Nothing good comes from that. If you are just out of high school, you reach the age of puberty, and you want to get married, then speak to your parents. Parents, support your children. If you know they're going to commit sin, if they're not married at a young age, then get them married and support them. That is part of our duty to our children. One of the problems that plague our society is that we expect the married couple, subhanAllah, like magic, they're going to have everything and life is going to be perfect. That doesn't foster halal love. No, it doesn't. Because we're human beings. We have desires. We have our weaknesses. And as elders, we need to help and groom our youngsters in order to not fall into the traps of shaitan. Because when you deny ourselves certain things, we can only go so long. We'll fall into sin. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and I'll quote to this hadith, O young men, when you reach the age to get married, get married. And if you can't, fast. If you can't, fast. So my dear brothers and sisters, let us indulge in love, love of Allah, love of the Rasul, loving our parents, loving our brothers, our sisters, our neighbors, loving our spouses. It is all halal. And let us protect ourselves and safeguard ourselves from falling into the love which will lead us to sin and damnation and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide our hearts, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill our hearts with love that is good. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eradicate us from the love that can lead us into temptation and lead us into destruction. Ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa akhiru da'wani alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, habibina wa nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in, wa man ihtada bi ihsan illa yawmiddin, amma ba'd. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. اللهم أعز الإسلام المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم انصر الإسلام المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم انصر الإسلام المسلمين والمجاهدين في فلسطين اللهم انصر لإخواننا في أفغانستان وفي العراق وفي سوريا وفي اليمن وفي كل مكان اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من عذاب القبر ومن عذاب الجهنم ومن فتنة المحيا وممات ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من البرص والجنون والجذام ومن سيء الأسقام آمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين عباد الله إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم واستعينوا يستجب لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر وأقيموا الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا